Tonight on Elvis Book Club.
Understandably, the healing business was kept quiet, even among our group. In the 70s, though, I witnessed hundreds of concertgoers carrying their sick or crippled children to the stage and crying out, "Elvis, please touch my baby," or "Elvis, just hold her for a minute." Few fans knew of his studies then, and yet thousands apparently sensed that he had some ability to heal.
One, two, three, four!
Welcome to the Elvis Book Club. I'm here talking to my good friend, Pat. What's up, Pat?
Hey.
I'm Brad. What do we read this week, Pat?
This week we read If I Can Dream, Elvis's Own Story by Larry Geller, who is, as billed on the front cover of this book, his close friend, confidant, and spiritual advisor.
Yet another confidant. But this one has has a pretty good pedigree.
Yes. In addition to all those things, he was Elvis's personal hairstylist.
Hair architect.
Yes.
To use his phrase, hair architecture. Who is this dude?
So Larry Geller was introduced to Elvis in Southern California in the 60s when Elvis was making movies.
Yeah. It should be noted that Elvis's previous hairstylist's name was Sal Orifice.
Is it possibly pronounced some different way, like Orifice or something like that?
I think he is Italian. Yeah. But yeah, spelled in an unfortunate way, I would say. Larry was, at the time, part of Jay Sebring's salon. Jay Sebring, of course, world famous hairstylist.
Victim.
Yeah, and Manson victim. Invented a certain way of cutting men's hair that propelled him to fame and fortune, which he called hair architecture. And he also invented using a handheld blow dryer on men's hair.
Which blows my mind. No pun intended.
I bet it does. Why does it blow your mind?
Well, handheld hair dryers, it's just something I take for granted, Brad. The fact that that had to be discovered is just, it's amazing to me.
Yeah. Well, it takes a pioneer. So Elvis beckons Larry to the home or his house in L.A. They inevitably hole up in his bathroom.
Right.
Which is disgusting. And how long, and that became then the pattern for the rest of their relationship.
Right. There'd be a session of doing hair and then an even longer session of heart-to-heart talks about spiritual matters.
Yeah.
Which is Larry's big thing. He's got a real interest in all things spiritual.
And these extended talks all took place in a closed bathroom, which I find personally vomitous.
I mean, at the very least, I imagine a very claustrophobic situation. Guys like sitting on the floor, their heads against the toilet and stuff. Just chilling. But I'm sure Elvis had a bigger bathroom than that.
Yeah, but probably not that big. I mean, it was the 60s.
Yeah.
So our ideas of what a large bathroom is nowadays, I think back then it was just unheard of. But I do picture his bathrooms always having very thick carpeting.
Yeah, see, in my mind's eye, it's a tile floor, but it's got a real, like, skein of grodiness.
Yeah.
Like old pee around the back of the toilet.
Yep.
And hair.
Elvis's baby fine hair.
Right. Yeah.
Limp baby fine hair.
Right. Jet black.
I think I'd take tile over carpeting. Carpet
I
in
would
a bathroom
too,
is like,
but oof. I mean, yeah, with the tile, you see exactly what you're getting.
Yeah.
Like maybe with the carpet, you could fool yourself into thinking that it wasn't as gross as it is.
I feel like with the carpet, it's kind of the difference between old horror movies where they leave it all to your imagination and new horror movies where you see it all.
You see it
all.
I
think that's carpet versus tile in a bathroom.
Yeah.
Ugh. But we should move on.
Well, in that first meeting, I just got to say this too. In the first meeting too, like I'm sure down the line, well, I think Larry even references at some point, maybe it's at Graceland, like there's a big heavy barber chair in his personal dressing room or whatever. But just in that first meeting, I feel like Elvis just like whips out a lawn chair back to the sink, like has Larry shampoo his hair.
It's probably not far off. I mean, I don't think Elvis in his house, do you think he had one of those like barber sinks that have like the indentations so you can
rest your
neck on it?
Eventually, he probably did at that time. Like by the time he meets Larry, I think he's made a couple of movies. He knows what he's doing.
Yeah. And he bought a Hollywood house.
Yeah.
So I think that's probably standard.
Yeah.
Right?
I would think so.
You know how they are out there.
Yeah.
In Hollywood. So this first meeting, Larry cuts his hair, does a bang up job, I'm sure.
And I think he cuts his hair in the book, it says for 30 to 60 minutes. Then they spend like, I don't know, is it like 3 hours? The talking goes on for a lot longer than the haircut.
Because at the end of the actual clipping, Elvis says something to the effect of, you know, Larry, I hear you're an interesting guy. what are you into? And Larry's like, you know, Larry's a proto hippie, proto new age.
Yeah.
This is still kind of the mid early 60s. And he unloads his spiel of, you know, all his spiritual thoughts. And Elvis says something to the effect of,
Whoa, man. Larry, I don't believe it. I mean, what you're talking about is what I secretly think about all the time, especially at night when I'm in bed.
So Elvis has finally found someone who can speak directly to his heart. And so with many people who enter Elvis's lives, especially as told in books they write, Elvis has immediately found his soulmate. And what's definitely true is Elvis, in keeping with his character, you know, wants this person there all the time. And like, you're now working for me, full-time guy. I don't remember necessarily if there was any real lag between the first meeting and...
There's not much lag, if there is. And basically Elvis calls him up and says, you should come work for me. And then he goes to the J. Sebring salon, pretty much immediately goes and like gives his notice, which J. Sebring isn't too cool with, right? So there's a little static around that, but he leaves. And his haste in packing up his junk at the salon, he falls and like hurts his arm.
Right, right.
And he doesn't want to take care of it because he's afraid that if he has to like take time off to let his arm heal, that he's going to miss this opportunity with Elvis. So the next day he goes on set and cuts Elvis's hair with a very painful arm, which he finds out later is broken.
I've fallen into similar traps. I remember when I was first dating the woman who I eventually married and then eventually divorced, she had a very busy job. So I had very few periods of time to really hang out with her.
Mm-hmm.
And it was it was cold and flu season. So I was very worried about getting sick.
Yeah.
So I was constantly taking enormous amounts of like airborne, you know, all that shit.
Yeah.
Which just makes, I don't know how it reacts to other people, but me, it just made me poor sweat. And so often we'd be hanging out and I would just be dripping sweat because been like so concerned about being ill.
Well, you know, Elvis would be really impressed by that because there's a story in this book about sweating. It's like Sam Cooke.
I think it's Wilson Pickett.
Wilson Pickett
was the sweater.
Yeah. Elvis goes to see him in concert and is super impressed that he sweats so much. And so after the show, the secret is Wilson Pickett like takes a bunch of like a handful of salt pills, which I guess is not very good for you, but then you sweat a lot and I guess it looks really cool on stage.
Did Elvis use that technique?
I don't know. He may have used it as a weight loss technique.
I bet Elvis was sweating plenty. I mean, certainly in the later years, he was sweating without any need to take pills to sweat. And I also think during his early years, I always imagine that heavily pomaded hair
would
get you, like, it's not breathing at all, right?
Yeah.
It just feels like you'd just be pouring sweat anyway.
I would think so,
Getting a bunch of zits on your scalp from all that, right?
Yeah.
Gotta get some air in there.
Yeah.
You gotta go with the dry look.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Use a blow dryer.
So Larry, he's a Southern California kid of somewhat interesting pedigree, and his dad had a couple fun professions.
Yes.
What do you consider the funnest?
I love this detail. As a young man, Larry's father played in a couple of different harmonica groups, which I guess was a big thing in vaudeville at the time. The names of these groups: Bora Minovich's Harmonica Rascals, and later on he played with Joey Hoffman's Ragamuffins, which.
Those both sound like SCTV creations.
Harmonica
combos were a big deal. I know when I first started buying used records in the 90s, you know, you go to thrift stores and it was stuffed. Like you would find a zillion Christmas albums, of course, like Firestone Christmas.
Yeah.
And then there was always like a Johnny Pueblo, always a bunch of harmonica albums, which is insane.
Yeah.
Like, the idea of like, oh, I want to relax after a hard day's work, listen to like six guys playing harmonica at once.
Yeah.
It's like nuts.
Tastes change, I guess.
Maybe it has something to do with all these guys coming back from World War II. Like maybe all like their ears are blown from mortars and like somehow maybe that's like a tone that can get into their ears. You know?
I don't know.
So beyond being a professional harmonicist, Larry's father, in his free time, was a healer, right?
Yes. And it kind of starts, they come to Southern California, like the whole family. Larry's grandma went out one day and she was wearing a fake fur. And because she looked like a rich lady in a fur, she was abducted and ended up murdered and thrown in the ocean. And this had a huge effect on the family, obviously. It caused Larry's mom to sort of question everything. And as she gets into her spiritual journey, the dad, I guess, is open to that too. And he starts studying the art of Jorei, J-O-H-R-E-I, which is a focused energy healing. The laying on of hands, basically, but I think with an Eastern origin, maybe Japanese. He gets into this like healing touch stuff, which he practices on Larry while Larry is asleep.
That's right.
and the grandmother's murder also has a spiritual aspect in that when this happened, Larry was on a bus on his way back from scout camp. And on this trip home, his gaze is drawn to the ocean and thoughts of his grandmother. And when he gets home, he finds out his grandma's been murdered. So
freaky.
For some reason, this brings to mind like the Black Dahlia.
Yeah.
Like, I think Larry's grandma was like beaten to death probably or stabbed. I don't know. I don't know if they go into like how exactly she got it, but I imagine they like beat her up really bad and threw her in the ocean.
Is that what you imagine?
That's what I... But I could very easily see her just eviscerated on the side of the road, just like the Black Dahlia. Just like the darkness of Southern California, Jay Sebring, the relationship to Manson with that, the murder of Larry's grandmother, and that dark aspect of California really touches Larry.
I know exactly what you're talking about. It's a real James Ellroy kind of world.
Yeah, exactly.
Right? And it's the same time frame, too, 50s and stuff. So he really is in that. And beyond that, Larry, as a boy, is friends with...
Phil Spector.
Yeah, another nexus of Southern California darkness.
Yeah, for sure.
Very interesting for Larry to come out of that.
And it's funny, none of that really touched Elvis. Like, I don't associate that stuff with Elvis, but you mentioned to me another time that, like, while, like, the Manson murders are going on, he's present in Los Angeles at that time making movies, so.
Yeah, that had never occurred to me that, you know, as you always hear about the paranoia in the community of stars in that area immediately after the Manson murders, immediately after, like, Sebring and Sharon Tate got murdered.
Right.
And yeah, I'd never considered the fact that, yeah, of course, Elvis had a house there. He
right.
was living there. He was part of the year. So he was involved in that. And then, yeah, that was a short leap to realizing that that was, in fact, the Once Upon a Time in Hollywood I wish we had seen.
Yeah.
Which is the Manson family breaking into a house that's Elvis and the Memphis Mafia. It's Red West and Sonny and Lamar and Charlie. Yeah. Charlie crying in the corner as the rest of them just karate these girls to death.
Oh, I know. Somebody's definitely going to get it with a pool cue in that movie. Oh,
yeah. Elvis is a known offender with pool cues.
Yeah, or cue balls, depending on who you're listening to, I guess.
Oh, dude, they would tear him up.
I could see it too, where like they spend a whole bunch of time just like beating those people to death. And then as an afterthought, Elvis is like, oh yeah, I'm also like strapped. Just like shoot, goes around just like shooting guys, putting them out of their misery.
One in each hand. Oh, that's Elvis. Then just throws them all in the pool. And then the cops show up and Elvis is waving one of his badges. Like, it's all right. It's okay.
My name's right here in this book. It's okay.
Yeah. Let's talk, before we move too far away from it, I do want to talk about, you'd mentioned briefly that Larry's father would practice his healing art on Larry when he was asleep.
Yeah.
And what was the story? Like, he had like some boyhood injury.
Yeah. So it says here that Larry's dad, when I asked him why he practiced Jorei on me only when I slept, he confided that he had been worried I'd resist the treatment and that people who heard about it would scoff. When I told my father that I wanted to learn about Jorei, he was pleasantly surprised and agreed to teach me.
Well, this healing then became a big part of Elvis's and Larry's relationship, where Elvis would, especially as he got in later years of his life and his health started to decline precipitously, he would very often be asking Larry to come in and lay some hands on him and heal.
Yeah, yep.
At the end of the book, Larry goes into his retelling of Elvis's last year of his life, and there are moments where he seems to be almost constantly in pain.
Yeah.
Always looking for something to help him. And this is a guy who's already just like filled to the brim with drugs.
Right.
They're not doing anything. You know, at one point he has all these bruises all over him.
Yeah.
From like, I think, a failing kidney.
Yeah.
Or liver, I guess.
Yeah. Elvis has got a lot of problems.
Yeah. Yeah. Among them, at least by Vernon's standards, is being Jewish.
That's right. So it's in Is Elvis Alive, the author, makes a big deal of there being a Jewish star on Gladys's grave and there wasn't one on Elvis's. Well, I think the reason for that is I don't think Vernon was too fond of Judaism.
Yeah.
And I don't know that that's an attitude that he like went out of his way to cultivate as much as it was just sort of the cultural norm of the South.
Yeah, it doesn't seem like he's necessarily that as much as he is just conscious of the greater community's attitudes. Gladys pulls aside a young Elvis and confides to him that her maternal grandmother was Jewish.
Right. And this is kind of a bombshell from this book, right?
That Elvis is a Jewish entertainer? That's never been a part of his bio at all.
And it's interesting to note also that Gladys reveals this to Elvis, but then is kind of wants him to keep it on the hush-hush because one of the big reasons is, like, Daddy wouldn't like that.
Yeah, that's part of it. But I think also just the general vibe down there at that time seemed not too encouraging of that.
Right.
So they hit it off. The guys are not necessarily immediately welcoming to Larry.
No, and I don't know that they're ever very welcoming with Larry.
With the exception of, I guess I would be mistaken in including Vernon in the guys. Vernon is his own category.
Yes.
Vernon, we can say, at beginning was hesitant to embrace Larry. But as time goes on, especially towards the end of the book, he spends a lot of time dressing down the guys and then pulling Larry aside and being very clear that Larry isn't part of that.
Yeah, like, you're Larry's not part of the problem.
Larry's one of the good ones.
Yep.
And Vernon's very appreciative of everything he's done for Elvis.
Yeah.
But yeah, I think you're right. The guys are very cold to Larry to be start, which makes a lot of sense. I mean, he's a male hairdresser from Southern California.
Right, who's spending hours at a time in the bathroom with their boss.
Talking about books.
Right.
And none of them are fond of books.
No.
Whatsoever. At one point, I remember there was a quote, something about Priscilla coming in at one point. Priscilla also eventually didn't really care for the spiritual books.
Right.
And she comes in at one point and says, "Oh, what are you guys doing?" "Oh, I see. Reading." Yeah. And the guys are even more coarse in their disdain.
And Larry's got a lot going against him with those guys. So, I mean, the fact that he reads, that's bad. The subject matter, I'm sure, did not help. Like, the spiritual stuff. Larry's accused of using psychology on people.
Yeah. At one point, one of the Memphis Mafia makes the remark that Elvis is upstairs reading. He goes, "Oh, he's up there scrambling his brains."
And Larry also, so he becomes a target of their frustration, I think, because they can't express their frustration with Elvis, right? So Larry becomes kind of their de facto lightning rod.
Their discomfort with Elvis's spiritual quest, they can't take it out directly on Elvis.
Exactly.
But since Larry is part and parcel of that, they can ride Larry.
But I mean, as far as what's related in the book, it doesn't come to much more than just like some snide comments here and there.
Yeah.
There are a couple of more serious run-ins with Red in particular, but like they certainly get along day to day just fine. But Larry's never really one of the guys either.
Though in reading the book, I could very much imagine that this is a situation where none of the other guys, if you read their recollections of Larry, none of them would think they thought of Larry any different than the rest of them.
Yeah.
There is a vibe to Larry that you can kind of see him maybe having a bit of an outsider complex.
I see. Yeah. Maybe that makes sense.
But there is some choice stuff. I mean, at one point, Larry's like playing Beethoven or something.
Larry being the
cultured.
The Renaissance man that he is. there's a lot of like downtime on movie sets when he's doing Elvis's hair. So one of the things he does to pass the time is start to learn the guitar. And he's in Elvis's trailer and he's picking around on some like Bach or Beethoven piece. And then one of the fellas overhears and...
Yeah, one of the guys comes in and hears this music being played and says something about like, "What is this Hong Kong shit?"
Yeah. And I think Larry's response is like, "Oh, it's Bach, you Philistine."
And he packed up all his shampoos and stormed out. Yeah. I don't know. That's what you want from the Memphis Mafia. Yeah, I don't want any of those walking into that room and going like, "Hey, this is nice. Tell me about it.
Right.
Teach me." And then sitting down like, "Where's this music come from?"
Right. Which is something, I mean, it wasn't so much with the music, obviously, but that seemed to be like Elvis was always putting Larry in this position of trying to impress these guys. They travel by bus for a long time because Elvis is afraid of flying for a while. And on one of these bus rides, I think Larry gets hopped up on some pills at Elvis's behest. And Elvis urges him to like talk about all the books you've read because I think it'll do the guys some good.
Yeah.
And Larry in a pill fog just like talks and talks and talks for hours to these guys, which, God, I think I would resent Larry too.
Oh, for sure.
God.
Just like pedantic talk about some like nonsense LA spirituality.
But Elvis is really hoping that this stuff is going to rub off on the guys because it's going to do them some good.
Yeah. It is weird that he makes Larry. I mean, you think like Elvis, their unquestioned ruler. should be able to just be like, sit down, as he does later quite a bit.
Yeah.
Sit down. I'm going to read a bunch of passages to you from the prophet or from the impersonal life.
That's definitely an Elvis thing.
Yeah.
Sermonizing.
I mean, Elvis gave him Dexedrine the very first time they drove from LA back to Memphis because Elvis didn't like to fly, so he'd always drive. I think he's like dishing out like, why don't you take some of these? And then, tell the guys about, you know, about the laying of hands. Go show Lamar about how you heal. He's got a hurt nipple.
Yeah.
Red gave him a real titty twister.
Yeah. He drove himself under a bus with this motorcycle. Needs a little help.
So they'd all be in like an RV, I guess, or a caravan of RVs. And it was during one of those trips where Elvis had his giant epiphany.
Right.
Which Elvis is increasingly like, at this point, he's doing all this reading and becoming almost frantically disappointed that he hasn't broken through yet.
Yeah, so it's on a bus trip from Memphis back to Hollywood, and Elvis, he's always like putting off leaving. They always like wait to the very last minute.
Well, since they don't have much time, that means they're basically riding straight through the night. So they're all popping pills and doing this drive without stops.
Yeah, and they must be taking turns because at some point Elvis is actually driving the bus.
Yeah. Let me interject.
Yes.
And we'll get back to this story. Mm-hmm. But just gut answer. Mm-hmm. Was Elvis a good driver?
Yes. I bet he was a good driver, but I also think it would be like scary. Like, I feel like Elvis is all about like pushing the limits of whatever vehicle he's in.
Wow. And including the human body.
Yeah. He's all about like getting everything he can out of these like performance vehicles that he has. So I bet he's like a really good driver, but I bet it's like a terrifying to sit in the passenger seat with him.
I buy that. Okay. Continue. Thank you.
Yeah, so they're on this bus trip. At some point, I don't know if he's driving and talking to Larry at the same time. And he's really bummed about, like, I've done all this reading. I so want God to speak to me. I want the spiritual awakening, but it's not coming. And Larry's like, well, let me tell you how it is, E. It's not how it works. Like, you just have to, like, let it come to you.
Yeah.
And when you least expect it, it's going to happen. And so Elvis takes that information and doesn't seem like super satisfied. And during the trip, they end up in the desert. And I took it as like there's a tour bus and then there's a caravan of other vehicles with the guys in it.
Yeah.
The bus somehow gets separated from the rest of the vehicles. So it's just Elvis and Larry and some of the other guys in the bus by themselves. And at some point in the desert, Elvis sees something. And he's got to stop the bus. He sees a formation in the clouds and like, this is it. Like God is speaking to him. And how has God spoken to him? He's shown him an image of Joseph Stalin in the clouds. And Elvis sees this. They stop the bus. They get out and he's fucking freaking out. Like because this is it. This is his like moment. A moment that, as Larry tells it, changes Elvis's life. This is God speaking to Elvis.
Yeah.
And Elvis feels it.
He's wigging. They've pulled over in the desert. And I just get the impression Elvis just like ran out into the desert.
Yeah.
And Larry had to kind of run and follow him. The rest of the guys are just looking out the window.
Yeah, right. Like waking up. And
yeah. Like, what? what's Stalin doing up there?
Yeah. But the image of Stalin then morphs into an image of Jesus, right?
Yeah.
So like, there you go.
That was it. That's what sold Elvis.
Right.
And then he's shouting at Larry in the desert, like, don't you see? God. God is love. Love is God. That shit. I mean, his mind is properly blown.
Yeah. This to me seems like crazy. And it doesn't give anyone else pause in this book. It doesn't give Larry pause. No one stops to think about just how weird this is.
Yeah.
You see a picture of Joseph Stalin in the clouds and that's God talking to you? Like, huh?
I think it's that it turned into Jesus. I think that's the important turn. Because I think just seeing Stalin, it's like, that's like a, that's more like a vision Roger Waters would have had.
But it's almost, but the transformation into Jesus is almost like an afterthought in this book. Like, it's definitely like, it's Joseph Stalin in the clouds. And it's good enough for Larry because this, according to him, is a legit spiritual experience that changes Elvis's life forever.
It absolutely does. And Larry is probably aided in accepting this by the very fact that Elvis's epiphany happened in almost exactly the same spot vast desert that Larry had earlier had his own epiphany. So there's something about this, it's probably the ley lines, I imagine, or some kind of like sacred geometry of the rocks, which is creating this. So
Or just Native Americans.
Probably that is a big part of it.
Yeah.
And probably Larry being very tired and just wanting to get to LA. And be like, okay, let's get on the bus. And
yeah.
So, but then they get to LA and, you know, they're all hunkered up in the hotel rooms. And then Larry is summoned to Elvis's room. And I don't know if at this point, but I imagine this is the case. Certainly later on, Elvis is routinely, if Elvis isn't on stage, he's in a hooded blue robe, usually carrying spiritual books, very much like a monk.
Yeah.
So I imagine in this case, he probably was in his blue robe. But he announces to Larry that he's been thinking about his revelation and he's going to quit being a star. He's going to drop out of this movie because he wants to join a monastery. And he says, I know this is a big decision, but I trust you completely, Larry, as my hairstylist slash confidant. I will do what you tell me. So should I continue to be Elvis Presley, the world's most famous man, or should I quit now, having now seen Stalin in the clouds and become a monk? To which Larry, in Larry's credit, gives Elvis the best answer, which is...
Go to sleep, Elvis.
Yeah, why don't you sleep on it and see how you feel. And lo and behold, I think the next morning, Elvis is like, Well, banana split breakfast or go drive over to the monastery? Well, let's have a couple banana splits. And one thing leads to another.
Yeah.
Genuinely a world-changing decision. If Elvis in early 60s had done like a Leonard Cohen and just dropped out and entered into some, like, you know, some monastic religious study.
Yeah. It's not a world I want to live in.
No, this would be an even duller podcast if we were just talking about Elvis's teachings. So the psychology Larry is accused of using on the guys is extraordinarily funny and plays a big role in this book. It's this idea that the guys are worried because of all the time Larry is spending with Elvis alone that he's using psychology on him. Mm-hmm. And also using psychology on them. So they're very wary. I don't know what they think psychology is. Yeah. Like, it's a very...
Yeah, right? it's very much like Elmer Fudd, Bugs Bunny.
It's a superstition that's taken a half step towards science.
Yeah.
You know, it's the same thing, like, oh, this guy, this outsider, is probably, like, weaving webs, like, doing witchcraft on our brains.
Yeah, yeah.
But, like, they've heard this word psychology, so they're just kind of subbing that in, essentially.
Well, and Larry's not going to be the only guy, like, working psychology on people, right? This kind of brings up the Colonel and his masterful head games.
And we should say now, you know, our eternal quest here is to find the truth about Elvis. And so each book is its own version of that truth. It's a Rashomon situation. Mm-hmm. But this is yet another book. This and Gale both require, if one is to believe their narrative fully, that multiple people involved in the stories have psychic powers.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
I mean, this one has Elvis having the power of healing. The Colonel is a master hypnotist.
Right. There's mention, I think, of Gladys having premonitions.
Yes.
I mean, there's the famous story of like a car fire on the way to or from the Louisiana hayride that she somehow knows about.
Right.
So the story that you're getting at now is like, yes, they're on a movie set. Elvis is off doing something. The Colonel comes in and there are a couple of guys hanging around. With Larry, there's Charlie, and I can't remember the other guy.
It's Billy or Marty, I think.
The Colonel is like, is hypnotizing these guys to do stuff. He comes in and basically tells like, Charlie, you're going to act like a dog. And then the other guy, you're going to act like a monkey.
Yep.
And then as it's told, like, this is what the guys do. Like howling and ooh and ah and kind of stuff.
Yeah.
Is happening.
And I don't even know if he actually says to them what his expectations. Like,
yeah.
I think in the story, like, he just walks on the set. It's an active movie. Movie set, and whoever it is, Marty or Billy, just drops down and starts, ooh, ah! And then he like turns his gaze onto Charlie, who just drops to all fours. It's like, ruff, ruff, which Larry sells in the book as a sign of him being a master hypnotist.
Right.
And there is a big turning point that we'll have to discuss that comes later where he turns that hypnotic powers on Elvis. But I think it's much more believable to think that this is only a display of his power of those guys and their acknowledgement of that power.
Yep.
At some point, I imagine they were all in a room together. The Colonel was telling them that he is hypnotizing them.
Mm-hmm.
He's saying, Charlie, I'm going to hypnotize you right now. And when I snap my finger, you're going to think you're a dog. And that's going to be the case for the rest of your life. And Charlie goes, okay. And then he goes, okay, Colonel. And then he goes through the entire hypnotic, you know, he gets out his pocket watch and all that. And I'm sure the entire time, the Colonel, Charlie, and everyone else in the room is going, there is no hypnotism happening.
Right.
And we all know this.
Right.
Right? And then he puts his watch away and snaps his fingers, and Charlie drops to his knees, right? And then for the rest of his life, you know, anytime the Colonel shows up and does that, right?
And and maybe Charlie's not the best example, because I could also see, like, Charlie is a guy who really likes to get a laugh, right? Mm. And pretty much every story you hear about Charlie, like, he's somehow lightening the mood. So, like, if Charlie can get people to laugh, he's going to do it. But, and maybe the Colonel knows that. So, like, it all works to the same effect, no matter what's going on.
Yeah. I mean, I would say even if Charlie was, like, dropping to his knees in that first instance, as the years pass, there is a point where it's not a laugh anymore. And it's just Charlie dropping to his knees. The Colonel's basically has this power.
Right.
So that's a very cool thing. The idea of Larry's world where the Colonel has these eerie powers. Mm-hmm. And in fact, the Colonel is very concerned about Larry's eerie powers. But do you think Larry is genuine in his spiritual beliefs? Like, do you think he genuinely thinks he can heal by laying of hands?
I do.
I do too.
Yeah.
I think he's earnest. Like, reading this book, I think there's a credibility to him.
Right.
Which is troubling to me, because in reading the book, I did have that feeling as I read it. I thought, like, this is a good accounting of these times. Like, this seems pretty fair-handed. Mm-hmm. And yet, when I was then accumulating my notes, you know, all the individual incidents start to really stand out.
Right.
Outside of the dross of all the verbiage surrounding them. And you realize, like, God, half of this crap is just fucking insane. Like,
yeah.
It's all visions and, healing and all this crap. And it's like, you can't help but think, like, maybe he's using psychology on us. Like, in his book.
Oh, no.
Right?
Then he's the master.
Well, he might be that good.
He's hypnotizing us through a book.
He might be that good. Or he just knows how to, like, lay things out. I know very early on, I was sold because there is this story about Larry and his friends first meeting Elvis, which is well before they started working together. Mm-hmm. Larry's a teenager in L.A. with his buddies.
Yeah.
They go to see an Elvis show, don't have tickets, and can't get in.
Right.
So they're horsing around behind the auditorium or whatever. Mm-hmm. And lo and behold, Elvis and a couple of the guys are back there leaning against a car being cool.
Yeah.
Larry works up the gumption to go say hi, and he has a brief chat with Elvis.
And shakes his hand?
Yes. They touch each other and probably heal one another's sore palms. And then that's it. That's the end of the story.
Right.
And that, for me, was a very compelling and believable anecdote. And it set the stage for my belief in him.
And it's reinforced later on, because he brings that story up with Elvis later. And Elvis is like, oh, I didn't remember that.
Yeah.
Which, I don't know, if you're way into your own shit and you're writing your book, that's a perfect opportunity to be like, Elvis then told me, like, yes, I remembered that meeting. It touched me deeply in my soul, because it felt like I'd met a brother that I didn't have.
Yeah.
You know?
I remember when we shook hands, a spark went between my hand and that man.
Yeah.
I knew someday we would, reunite.
Right. 100%. Our paths would cross again.
Yeah. And also the fact that that story ends with those guys not getting into the concert.
Yeah.
Almost being like, well, enjoy the parking lot. See ya. I mean, that's such an easy get. Like, and then he let us in and we had a great time and blah, blah, blah.
Right.
So, that set the stage. I think that's part of his psychology. He knows early on, you get him believing, you tell him something very true and get him believing. Mm-hmm. And then you start unraveling, healing, and all this stuff. Mm-hmm. And dupes like us are like, oh, this Larry Geller's an all right guy.
Sounds good.
He's an okay guy. Arf, arf, arf. Right? So, the Colonel's hypnotism comes right before there's a period where Larry is fired. You balk at this designation.
Is he fired, or does Larry decide to leave?
I mean, do you think he was not directly fired?
I mean, that seems to be the way with Elvis. Elvis is not a big fan of confrontation, but, like, I don't know. Larry makes a big deal of going off to think and writing a big, long letter to Elvis about why he's leaving.
Right. So as the story goes, they're in L.A., and Elvis gets up one night and goes to the bathroom and allegedly trips over a TV cord.
Yes.
Eats shit. And I say allegedly because there are questions about this. Most notably, the fact that when Elvis fell, he hit the back of his head, which if you trip, you tend to drop forward. And Elvis also says he felt like he was pushed. So I think Larry is kind of subtly setting the stage that there might have been an agent.
Some funny business.
Because what happens as a result is that Elvis is basically out for about a week, and he is just holed up in his bedroom. The colonel takes charge immediately and forbids anyone else from talking to Elvis. So there is a week where the colonel is going in and talking to Elvis all day long, every day. No one else can get to him.
Mm-hmm.
And when Elvis comes out, finally, after the week is done,
yeah,
he is like completely out of it, right?
The way Larry tells it, he's heavily fucked up on some. Like, he's not himself. And the colonel's by his side, kind of telling everybody how it's going to be now. And one of his big pronouncements is, no more of those books.
Yeah. Yeah. The way Larry presents it, it sounds like not only was the colonel just like pumping Elvis full of drugs, but was also using his hypnotic powers. You know, so Elvis comes out and the colonel makes these new proclamations, and Larry says Elvis is just kind of sitting there looking completely out of it, ashen, and not meeting anyone's eyes. And yeah, there's the proclamation about no more of these books, which I'm sure everyone was happy about. And I think kind of indirectly, he, through the books, there's a couple other things that more directly push Larry out to the point where Larry is just no longer in this privileged position he had been in, which leads to the quitting that you had mentioned earlier, right?
Yeah. So the colonel makes these proclamations with the drugged up Elvis. Later on, Elvis calls Larry and his wife into his room and says, like, no matter what happens, I love you guys.
Yeah.
Then they go back to work on whatever movie they're going on. And Elvis, I don't know, is in a really sour mood. And at some point is like railing on the masters and how they just want to control people's minds, man. And I think it's at this point that Larry's like, you know what? I need to step away. Mm. And in stepping away, he's summoned to Las Vegas. Like, Marty Lacker calls him and is like, hey, we got to go to Vegas now. The boss wants to go. And Larry's like, I just can't go. I got to skip it for my health or whatever. And that is when Elvis goes to Las Vegas and in kind of a whirlwind ceremony weds Priscilla.
Yeah.
And that's when things kind of end for Larry and Elvis' camp for the time being.
And that was particularly notable because secretly Elvis had decided that he wanted two best men, Marty Lacker and Larry.
And Larry, yeah.
But he tells Larry this and says, but keep it under your hat.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to tell Marty until the last minute either, so it'll be a surprise for him.
Yeah.
Just a fun surprise. You're half as important as you thought you were. Which sounds a little suspect, you know? Yeah, no one knew it because Elvis wanted to keep it a secret, but I was going to be his best man at his wedding. It's like, I can kind of also, well, tell me what you think. Could you see Elvis being a guy who may have, over the course of a year or so, told about six people that they're going to be his best man?
Yeah, I can see that.
So yeah, so he finally marries Priscilla, by all tellings, not that enthused about it. And yet Priscilla had been, when she first arrived on the scene, you know, Elvis was in a very desperate state where he seemed convinced that Scylla was going to save things and make things better.
Yeah.
He's kind of like a kid with everything he gets into. He needs it now and he can't think of anything else.
Mm-hmm.
And like, he's obsessed, right?
Yeah.
And that was Priscilla. And then he got Priscilla there and he's obsessed for a little bit. And then he kind of started wandering.
Yeah.
And this is the same thing we see in this book. First, that same obsession with Ginger, who is his last lady love,
yep,
after Linda takes off. But Ginger comes in. She's 19, I think, when they first start hanging out.
Mm-hmm.
And Elvis is obsessed with her.
Yeah.
By Larry's telling, he's really in his slide at this point. I mean, mm-hmm, it's mid-70s. And I would say this speaks directly to much of Gail's questions. And that's all she was doing. She was just asking questions about these, you know, Elvis's odd choices during his last year of life. Much of which she took as suggesting that he was preparing to
fake his own death.
But, which I think we noted at that point, could just as easily be read as a guy who was just completely given up.
Yeah.
And knew he was dying.
Right.
And it just, not only knew he was dying, knew his body was failing,
mm-hmm,
felt powerless to change anything around him, which this book really paints in a very compelling way.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you think?
I think so, yeah.
The physical shape he's in the mid-70s, as told by Larry's diaries. I mean, like we said, you know, he wakes up, he's covered in bruises, he's always in pain. He seems really to be leading an increasingly miserable life.
Yep.
Which I guess is the lot of all drug addicts at some point, no matter how rich you are. You're just gonna have nicer sheets on the bed you spend your entire life on.
Yeah.
And it really sounds like on stage he comes to life. Elvis seems to be fed by performing.
Yeah.
And it's really truly what he lives for.
Yep.
But increasingly his life off stage gets very small and very dark and very depressing.
Yes. He's created this bubble that he lives in, and he's just like this really deep rut.
Yeah.
Elvis is clearly a creature of habit, and he just doesn't have the fortitude to make the simplest changes, it seems to me. And he seems so afraid of change, you know, like it's a fear of the unknown or the struggle. You know, I think we've read more than once in these books how not a fan of confrontation he is. So like,
yeah.
He can't even confront, not with just people, but just like the issues in his life. I don't know. He just needs to make like the simplest effort, and he just seems incapable of doing that.
Yeah, he needs to be able to take an independent step, and he doesn't seem like he's willing to do that.
Right.
On some level, it almost feels like he eventually understands that and sees that that is partly why everything's kind of crumbling within him. And I think recognizing that and also feeling powerless to change it is probably a big turn for him, where he does feel like he just gives up at one point. Mm-hmm. In this book, like he acknowledges, like, I'm gonna die, there's nothing I can do about it.
Yeah. Why are you talking like that, E?
So in Larry's diary, it really paints the picture that Elvis is basically alone in his bedroom, looped out on drugs, and just ruminating. And the ruminations fixate on different things. I need this now, I need this, I need this. And of course nothing helps.
Mm-hmm.
And one of those things at one point is ginger.
Yeah.
And Ginger is, of course, flattered and interested and seems like a decent lady.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, she wants to date Elvis and all this. So she's game. But the level of devotion Elvis expects from this person is really off-putting.
Yeah. And it's so obviously hypocritical of Elvis, where like he demands her total attention. And so like she'll go and hang with her family or whatever, and Elvis resents that. Which, I don't know. I would think if anyone understood like someone's attachment to their family and their mom, like it would be Elvis. But there's no self-awareness as far as that goes at all.
Well, it really seems like a mental problem at this point, because you're right. Like, I would think if anything, Elvis would really value that.
Mm-hmm.
Like a young woman who really values her family. But he's at this point in his deterioration where he can't even see it.
Yeah. And he does that too. There's a story in the book where Linda Thompson's parents, like they're waiting at Graceland for him. I think this is while they're talking about the movie they're going to make. The karate movie.
New Gladiators.
Yeah. He's like so jazzed about that. He's like, you know, well, E, why don't you come on down? Linda's parents are downstairs. And he's like, no, they're just going to have to wait.
Yeah. I think he gets pissy. Like, I think he has them waiting for like an hour or two.
Yeah, yeah.
I think maybe
pretty
twice.
Disrespectful.
It's pretty shitty. Yeah, and he's up there just like pilled up telling Larry about, writing the New Gladiators.
Yeah, the spiritual origins of karate.
Yeah, and he wants Larry to write it because Larry knows about the spiritual meaning of colors, which makes it sound like a killer fucking book. Killer movie.
Yeah.
Like, I really wish that had gotten made. We really lost out by not having Elvis-produced movies.
Yeah. If Elvis had lived, like, it'd be a different thing completely, but just like Elvis and Cannonball Run movies.
Oh, wow.
Dude.
It's an interesting question, because you say that, and my immediate thought is, if Elvis makes a transition to those types of movies, does Burt Reynolds have that, his career as we know it? Because he's doing, a lot of that is kind of Elvis energy. And if you've got Elvis, I mean, you don't need Elvis and Bert in one movie.
I don't know.
Okay. You're right.
I'd watch it.
I mean, yeah, I'd definitely watch it, but it is like...
Very similar energies.
But hell yeah, Elvis and Dean Martin, Sammy.
There'd be a part for him in Smokey and the Bandit somewhere too, man.
You thinking the Jerry Reed?
Like, I could see him doing Jackie Gleason.
Yeah, I could see him doing that. He's a real ham kind of sense of humor.
Yeah, right? Yeah.
For sure.
Oh, but like Dom DeLuise, if anyone is like just thinking his lucky stars, that didn't happen. Then you got like two guys smacking you around in the credits.
That's absolutely true. Elvis would have loved to smack around Don DeLuise. I can just see them both on like Johnny Carson's show.
Yeah.
Just like knocking him around, laughing.
At some point, Dom DeLuise stops laughing.
Yeah. Because Bert's treating him like a piece of meat he owns. Like,
yeah.
Go on, Elvis, take a hit. Take a smack.
This fat fuck doesn't feel nothing.
Feels good, doesn't it? So
back to Ginger.
Yeah. Yeah, back to the darkness. So yeah, he's multiple incidents in this book where he takes Ginger to task for literally just calling her mom. I mean, it's awful because she is like 19 or 20.
Yeah.
And he starts, you know, he's indoctrinating her. He's reading her these books, which she can't possibly want to hear about.
I know, but she, along with Priscilla, is just a blank canvas for Elvis to project all of his like hopes and dreams and his road to salvation. He idealizes these two ladies, Ginger and Priscilla, in a way that's like turns them into something they can never live up to in his mind, right?
Yeah. Yeah, he's definitely putting completely unattainable demands on these women.
But the thing that's missing is seems to be just like a human, the relationship itself, like, do you want to hang out and do something fun, Elvis, and just like spend time together? It's like, no, I want to like turn you into this goddess in white who parrots back all this like spiritual shit that I'm pumping at you. And I just need a human heating pad in bed with me.
Yeah, he's kind of just wants a sidecar. Like, you don't forget the feeling that in any of this, he's entering into an actual relationship with any dynamic between the two. He is Elvis, and you are going to fill this slot. And yeah, it's complicated with Ginger because he is, he makes a lot about her being Gladys's reincarnation.
Oh, man. It's so tiresome and so icky. Just like, mentions it more than once in this book about like, I see my mother's eyes in Ginger. Just like Priscilla also like has a resemblance to Gladys in photos. And oh man, just so gross.
Yeah. He makes a big point of that. And he has a few like very key dream/visions that he shares with Larry that kind of support that and actually feed that idea. One in particular, like, I think it's Ginger talking with Elvis in the yard at Graceland, and then she turns directly into Gladys,
yeah,
who then jumps on a horse.
Yep.
Bareback, which is a big thing for Elvis. Mm-hmm. Like, it's bareback, that must mean something. And then just as she starts horsing away, riding the horse into the sunset, she turns and stops and says, it didn't work out with Priscilla because she was immoral.
Oh, right. She wasn't moral, right.
And of course, Elvis, that's, you know, a revelation because he needs constant revelations. He's like constantly looking for epiphany.
Yeah, he needs that jolt, man.
It's interesting, once again, that our feelings about the Greenwood book seem to be panning out in that I accept the idea that that book is completely made up.
Yeah.
You know, he is not related to Elvis. There's no secret aunt or any of this stuff. And yet, the psychology behind that book, the psychological machinations, seem very accurate.
Yeah.
I mean, they're inflated and they're darkened and they're turned into something completely insane in mm-hmm. the Greenwood book. But I think the basic ideas are like pretty accurate.
Yeah.
And we see it playing out here with Ginger being Gladys's reincarnation. He makes a big deal about, you know, as hard as his boners get, he's not having sex. They're not going all the way.
Right. Come close a couple of times, but I want to do it right this time, Larry.
Yeah. And he ickily tells Larry that a couple times, like, man, things got hot and heavy.
Yeah.
Things
are
really going. Man, my pants hurt, right? Yeah. Larry's just like, oh, yeah, great. So he makes a whole stink about not wanting to pork Ginger because she's moral and he wants to do the right thing mm-hmm. and all this shit. But then you think like, well, maybe that ties into her being, you know, in Elvis's kind of woozy, druggy mind. You know, it's also Gladys's reincarnation.
Yeah.
That he'd be like stuffing it in, which is kind of gross.
Yeah. It's really gross.
Taking a definitive stance on that?
Yeah.
I'm trying to think now. My mom's reincarnation. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'm with you. But what's also very interesting, a lot of this moralizing from Elvis may in fact have been as a kind of a cover his impotence.
Yeah. Well, he's got Elvis pretty much like lamenting to Larry. Like, it's not working. Like, he paints a picture that Elvis is in like a really, just like a real valley of his life as far like the stresses are piling up. He's being overworked and he's treating his body like shit.
Yeah, his body, they confirm in this book that he did have a twisted colon, mm-hmm. which Gail had said, and we kind of snickered at being less insensitive and thinking that was silly. But yeah, twisted colon, glaucoma, and bad kidney or liver, I forget. Whichever the ones, I think the
you
one.
Pick
that...
one. It's probably, you're probably right either way.
It was interesting, this obsession with like controlling Ginger and, you know, not having her talk with her family.
Mm-hmm.
Also, you know, earlier Larry talks about when Elvis bought the Circle G Ranch.
Yep.
Because he was out motorcycling and he saw this field with a 50-foot cross in it. It turned out to be a ranch that was for sale, or he just offered to buy. So he buys this ranch and he's going to have everyone live there. And it's going to be a way for him to regenerate, get back on track, get back to nature and all this. Mm-hmm. And so he does. He buys everyone like mobile homes, which he puts onto this ranch. They all move out there with the families.
Yep. They all get trucks and horses. He's just like throwing stuff at people.
And he gets them all out there and it kind of falls apart because people figure out where he lives immediately. Yeah. So he just has people standing at his fence, basically watching them do everything. So he kind of falls away. But like that and the whole ginger thing really made me consider the fact that Elvis, in a way, was not consciously moving into trying to create almost like a cult leader world.
Yeah.
Because he did consciously want the Circle G to be like a commune.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he gets all the families out there. They're all separated. They're all totally dependent on him for their livelihood. He's already into all these spiritual teachings. I mean, later on in the 70s, he's like sitting all the guys down, have Lamar read passages.
Yeah, those are great stories.
Yeah. And he's constantly reading passages at Ginger.
Mm-hmm.
You know, he's really taking, there's these little traits that all cults, these forms they all take.
And yeah.
He seems to be instinctively doing that.
Yeah.
We'll have to see if he tries to change anyone's diet in any of these books.
If anything, I think it's Larry trying to change his diet, and Elvis is pretty resistant to that.
Yeah.
Which is great. No, you talk about the cult leader and cult leader type behavior, and just specifically you talk about him having Lamar read passages from the book, and then him asking, well, what do you think about that, Lamar? And Lamar's reaction is like, I don't know what the hell I just read, which is funny. But then there's also the story where he gathers all the wives and girlfriends.
Yeah.
And he's got a stack of $100 bills. And yeah. He gives like an hour and a half like sermon about his spiritual studies or whatever.
Yeah.
I love that they're referred to as his studies.
Always studying.
And he makes them sit through this. And then he starts handing out $100 bills when he's done.
Yeah.
It's so great.
Crisp new 100 each wife. Yeah. That really struck me. Like, I would find that so fucking insufferable.
Oh, yeah.
And especially over years and years of this, mm-hmm. You know, if you're just like Sonny West.
Yeah, well, like, I mean, Larry does talk about like people rolling their eyes like behind his back and stuff. So,
yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, it is interesting. I think there is something to that kind of instinctively wanting to or forming this kind of cult mentality and like, trying to create that kind of community around mm-hmm. him. It's interesting.
If anything, he just doesn't have the follow through to like... He doesn't follow through with any of this stuff. And that's, you know, Larry's argument that he seems to be getting at. It's like, E was like a spiritual person and he was a lot deeper than we recognize. And like, mm-hmm. He really took this stuff seriously. But I don't buy that argument. Like, I do buy that he was interested in this stuff. But it always seems so like knee jerk. Tell me about that again, Larry. And these things occur to him in the moment. And it's like, yes, I'm super into this right now. But when it comes to like following the steps or like changing your diet or whatever, it's the same old thing.
Yeah.
Always. He doesn't follow through with any like meaningful change. It's just like, hey, Larry, bring me some more books.
Yeah.
It seems almost more about like amassing books than it does about seriously studying.
I mean, he definitely put the hours in. You know, he is spending like a decade surrounded by these books.
Mm-hmm.
I think he did the reading and like was serious about it, but I do agree with you that the follow-up is what you need. And I think Elvis was always looking for, and this is, I think, a young person's idea of like enlightenment is the lightning bolt, always looking for the epiphany.
Right.
Like, oh, I get it now.
Right.
And everything's cool. My whole perspective on life has changed.
Mm-hmm.
And I feel like that's what Elvis was always searching for. And you kind of get that if you read these books. It's like reading a self-help book.
Yeah.
Where you can read it and you're like, oh, that makes perfect sense. And it falls apart immediately.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas really, if you're on, an honest path to anywhere worth going spiritually, it's like, it seems it is a daily effort.
Yes.
And it's like, it's getting on it and continuing on to it. And like,
and it's a very unsexy process.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's no epiphanies. It's like more like you realize at one point, like, oh, I'm significantly healthier.
Yeah. It's not a lightning strike. It's like an accumulation or whatever. I don't know.
Yeah.
I guess if I knew, I'd.
We wouldn't be doing this stupid podcast. But yeah, I mean, the studying thing is very funny. I find that always an amusing turn of phrase. It's always used, his studies.
Uh-huh.
I always picture Elvis on a bunch of pillows in his bed with his readers on.
Yeah. And like you say, surrounded by books.
Surrounded.
They're all dog-eared and yeah.
Yeah, all like open and just kind of folded over
yeah.
So he can keep his place.
Right.
And he's completely out of his brain on drugs.
Mm-hmm.
Dozing off. and like half trying to read these things, and just, which is probably a great state to be in, because all these things just get like trapped into your subconscious, you know? You start dreaming about things and you don't know what's a dream and what's reality. I mean, just spaceship bedroom, you know?
Yeah.
And then you go trip over TV in your toilet.
Yeah, or fall asleep with a cheeseburger in your throat.
So there was one thing I thought was really funny. I guess harkening back to this idea that, like, I think Larry is using psychology on us through the book, and that I felt he was pretty credible until I kind of looked over my notes. Mm-hmm. There was one thing that really stuck out and I thought was so funny, is that after Elvis lets Larry go, this is like the late 60s. I think this is like 67 to like 72. Mm-hmm. He had a 5-year where, you know, the colonel hypnotized Elvis and got him to get rid of Larry. Mm-hmm. Larry says that during that time, he would often look back and see cars following him for a few blocks. And he's like, I knew that was Elvis just keeping tabs on me.
Yeah.
And what I thought was so funny about that is, what could Elvis possibly learn by only following you for a couple blocks? He's not learning where you're going. Just the fact that you go out and do stuff. That's what they're reporting back. So Charlie's coming back. Like, what'd you learn? It's like, he leaves the house occasionally. And where does he go? He just goes, man. All right, well, good work.
Style some people hate.
Yeah.
Well, you mentioned him being followed. And so that brings up a couple of other stories. The first of which is, he's a pot guy, right?
Yes.
So on his first stint with Elvis, he's married to a woman named Stevie. And they are in Memphis. And they, like so many people in the 60s, like to smoke a little weed from time to time. And they've run dry. So they write back home to their connection, hey, send us some weed. Here's a check.
Yeah, send us some lids.
Yeah. And so later on, he and his wife are driving around town in one of Elvis's cars, and they notice they're being followed. And so he gets to the gates of Graceland and notices this car kind of parked across the way. And then he goes kind of screeching after it on a hair-raising car chase. And eventually, I think, loses them or something. But after this car chase, the police come to pay a visit, and they decide to search his hotel room that he and his wife have been staying in. And there's a lot of threats made. The idea is they think he's a druggie and he's trafficking drugs or something. They want to bust this creepy pot guy.
Yeah, this creepy LA pot guy with beautiful hair.
Elvis is, of course, furious that they're giving his buddy a hard time, and talks about, if anything comes of this, we're picking up and we're leaving Memphis for good, which, all right, I guess.
Yeah.
But nothing comes of it, and Larry's really scared, and he spends the night in jail. And then he gets out the next morning to a very apologetic sheriff.
Yeah, well, they are in Memphis. This is right after Elvis hired him, or right when he was kind of feeling him out. So he, Larry, and Stevie go to Memphis for 3 months. Mm-hmm. Elvis's holiday break, and they know they're going to need weed, so they bring a pound of Acapulco gold. Mm-hmm. A pound of weed, which seems like a lot for 3 months, and I think they run out of that. Mm-hmm. And so they need to order more.
Yeah,
that whole story kind of blew my mind, because, like, it is early 60s or mid 60s, where, and in Memphis, where, like, drugs would be a big fucking deal.
Yeah, the tenor of that story was a little off-putting to me as far as Larry goes, because, like, that whole situation, he really puts Elvis in a bad spot, don't you think?
Sure.
And I think it doesn't make sense to me that Elvis's reaction to that is, like, if anything comes of this, we're moving out of Memphis. If I were Elvis, I'd be like, what are you doing, man? We got a good thing going here. Why do you want to fuck it up with that? I mean, it'd be one thing if you were scoring for Elvis or whatever, but it's made pretty clear throughout this book that Elvis is not a pot guy. And so I can't imagine that Elvis took a very favorable view of marijuana, especially at this time.
That is what shocked me as well, because I always assumed Elvis was very against pot. Mm-hmm. And so especially at this time, he would have been really upset.
Yeah.
But he has no problem at all with it. Elvis at one point calls Larry's supplier. So he knows the name and the phone number of this guy.
Yeah.
And there's no talk at all about Elvis being upset that all this drug stuff is going on. So, like, apparently he's pretty casual about it. And they do get into, Elvis does smoke pot in this book.
Yeah.
They do drop acid, which we should talk about.
Yeah.
And they do cocaine. But yeah, that's what really shocked me, is that his laissez-faire attitude towards it. Because, you got to remember, like, I think it was like 67, which is years after this, the Stones got busted with you know, drugs and weed. And it was a huge fucking scandal.
It was
scandal.
A huge deal that happened to the Beatles too, right? In England, like it was a big, big deal.
Yeah, Lennon was going to get deported from the U.S. because he had a marijuana possession bust in UK.
Yeah.
So it was that big of a deal.
Right.
You were like one of the biggest stars in the world and we're going to kick you out of the country because you have weed. So like years before that, in this like southern town, having a pound of marijuana being mailed to you.
Yeah. But it all works out in Larry's favor because the weed never comes, right?
I think because Elvis called the guy and said, don't mail it.
Yeah. And so after this whole portion of it, they still are on Larry's back. So he wakes up one morning to like pounding on their hotel room door and it's the sheriff and he's got a piece of mail for Larry. And he says, you're going to open this now. And Larry, of course, is very, you know, he's very nervous, but then he's very tickled when he opens up the mail and it's like two pictures of Jesus or something.
It's like a Jesus newsletter.
Yeah.
Like the front cover is a big picture of Jesus' face.
And after that, they didn't have any more problems with the cops.
Yeah. So, little did they know that newsletter was printed on bladder acid paper.
Yeah, probably.
Him and his wife just gobbled it up. Yeah.
But just like to reiterate, it's just like such a stupid move on Larry's part to like be doing that. And for Elvis to be like cool with that is that kind of blows my mind.
It's strange. And it gives a real credibility to the rest of Elvis's circle not wanting Larry around.
Yeah.
You know, Larry's always like, it's because I'm spiritually enlightening Elvis and I'm doing all these beautiful things. But it's like, no, it's like you're having pounds of drugs being shipped to you. Like you are trafficking weight.
Yeah.
You know? Yeah. Which is pretty valid. And he does get them all doing drugs. I mean, obviously Elvis was already doing drugs, but at one point Elvis goes on like a week of like smoking tons of weed.
There are a couple of things that he just kind of mentions. And one is the tons of weed. Like they spent a few days smoking weed and then it's like Elvis didn't really like it. So he didn't do it after that.
Well, it's because his tolerance is so high. He has to smoke so much because he's so used to regular, normal, or I don't want to use the words regular or normal.
Pharmaceutical grade?
Yes. That the weed doesn't really affect him. Yeah. So he's worried about his throat because he has to keep smoking.
Oh, that's right. So. And then there's a similar thing where it's like Elvis wants to get drunk.
Yeah.
So they go on like a 3-day bender where it's just like Charlie Hodge fixing him drinks and everybody's drunk. And I think they mentioned like 3 days and it's like, well, Elvis didn't really dig it. So he never really drank after that.
Yeah. They had him drinking 15 to 20 mixed drinks a day. So he would just drink all day drinking like serious liquor.
Yeah.
You know? But again, it's because he had this crazy tolerance and was like so used to being hammered.
Yeah. I didn't even think about it that way. Yeah.
That would kill a normal. I mean, that's for like a drunk 20 drinks is a fucking
that's
lot.
That's a lot.
And to have never had any experience with alcohol, like, holy shit.
I'm sure they're like the sugariest drinks too. Like,
dude.
It's just like headaches in a glass.
Oh, yeah.
It's just so icky.
For sure.
But then, I don't know if he talks about it before or after, but that leads to the Elvis wants to trip acid, which must have been very fashionable at the time because they get some other people on board. Let me see. It's Elvis, Larry, Priscilla, Jerry Schilling, and Sonny West decide to trip acid.
Window pane, as he calls it. Which do you know what that means? I've always heard window pane acid.
No idea, yeah.
If I were to ever do like a Nugget-style 60s garage rock psychedelic band, it'd be called Window Pane, P-A-I-N. That would be it's like the perfect band.
That's
name.
Good.
Thank you.
So it's not a very remarkable event. They take their acid and they're all trying to like be cool. Jerry disappears.
They take their acid. I think we just outed his bolt in total squares.
Jerry Schilling disappears and they find him like under a load of laundry in a closet, which I think is really funny.
He's definitely sniffing panties, right?
Yeah. But then she doesn't have a bad trip, but Scylla's kind of a bummer. She just starts like yelling at Elvis. Oh, you're going to leave me or you're cheating or whatever. She gets on.
You never loved me.
Yeah. That whole trip.
Heavy bummer.
Yeah.
You never
But draw. She snaps out of it eventually, and then they kind of ride it out. It sounds like it's pretty mild. Like, they watched the time machine, ate pizza, and marveled at the beauty of nature, and talked about what great friends they all were.
Yeah.
That's not a quote, but that's pretty much what happened.
That's nice.
Yeah.
Yeah. Priscilla definitely brought some heavy vibes to it.
Yeah.
Not cool. Never drop with your bitch. I think that's the take home from that book. Yeah. That's probably what Larry wants us to pull out of that story. Yeah, I was shocked by that. I had never really heard that elsewhere.
No.
I mean, that might be another case for Elvis. I mean, there's no talk of Elvis being affected at all. And again, that might be from the drugs. I mean, at one point, they talk about Elvis wanting to taper off of the drugs he was taking, which were sedatives, uppers, and hypnotics. And I don't know what a hypnotic is or why you would take that, but I got to imagine that must prep you in some way for a psychedelic experience.
Maybe so. I don't know. Would that be some kind of like mental health type drug? I don't know.
You're not well read when it comes to the PDR.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
The other thing was, and this was in, you know, like I say, I read the Goldman book, or at least I read the juicy bits, as I recall, and I think it's mostly juicy. But the only thing I can really remember from that book is that at one point they're talking about needing to like get Elvis ready for a show, and he's so whacked out on drugs that they like dip cotton balls into liquid cocaine and shove it up his nose, and then like walk him around like an OD victim until he comes to. And I always thought like that was just, that stuck in my head because that's such a gross image.
Yeah.
But also like that just seemed like the ultimate made up weird bullshit. But in this book,
there's liquid cocaine. It's such a great story too.
At one point, Larry comes in and Elvis is like, let me hear you snort, man. Let me hear you sniffing.
You're congested, man.
Yeah.
No, I'm not. No, you definitely are.
Yeah, here, take this.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, he does exactly that. He douses a cotton ball in cocaine and shoves it up Larry's nose.
Yeah.
And then he's like, that's liquid cocaine, man. Yeah.
I can't remember what was Larry's reaction to that.
I think they just had a great time. He said, like, we were just very high energy for 20 minutes. And then he was like, you know what? I think I'm still congested. So that was shocking to have that actually confirmed. Really freaked me out.
Yeah.
So one thing I thought was curious and worth talking about is Elvis gets rid of Larry from 67 to 72, which coincidentally is Elvis's career resurgence.
Yeah.
It's arguably the most fertile time of his career, certainly of his later career.
Yeah.
Outside of Sun, I would say, or like very early RCA. And he is arguably, and I would make that argument, doing the best work of his life in those years. And it's like, interesting that you get like, what did happen? Like, what changes did the Colonel make? You know, when he hypnotized Elvis and like put him on this new path, Elvis just blossoms.
Yeah.
And like, what happened? Or is that all in reaction to Elvis? Like, you know, Elvis's reaction to having being under that much control, he just put all that anger into the work. Or was Larry truly like fucking him up, truly scrambling his brains with all his Hong Kong shit, you know, feeding him windowpane acid, whatever that is, you know, and talking at him. You know, Elvis is on hypnotics and Larry's there like basically massaging his scalp and talking to him for hours.
Yeah, I love that. He's always asking Larry to come in and like rub him down.
Larry's always healing him.
Yes. I need a healing, man.
Yeah, which is very dark. And that's later on when Elvis is really sick. It actually gets very depressing. And he's like in pain all the time.
Yeah.
He's asking, and he's completely drugged up, still on pain. And then, yeah, he's always asking Larry to like lay hands on him and heal him. It's really, really sad.
Yeah.
But yeah, he gets rid of Larry and his career just lights up, which I thought was an interesting fact.
Yeah. I don't know. Is there a correlation or is it just timing?
I don't know. But then you look at Larry comes back in 72 and Elvis completely tanks again, right?
Yeah.
I mean, obviously, Larry doesn't highlight this in his telling, but it's an interesting timeline.
Yeah, that is interesting to think about.
And so maybe all the spiritual shit was bad for Elvis. Like, it genuinely just confused him.
Yeah, maybe it's just one less thing for him to have to think about, because that seems to me to be a big factor in his decline at the end. He has all these stressors, just the grueling touring. Towards the end, he's very worried about having let Sonny and Red and Dave go, and the What Happened book first, it's the prospect of it coming out. Like, what are they going to do? And then Larry finds out that it's coming out. He gets a galley proof from a fan whose life was spared by Elvis's How Great Thou Art album. Really weird.
Oh, right.
That book coming out really takes a toll on him.
Hugely.
And so when you think about that, maybe the spiritual stuff, it's just one thing that he's worried about in that time when Larry's away that he doesn't have to worry about anymore.
Well, I think as we kind of touched on earlier, like Elvis was happier when performing, though he wasn't necessarily happy touring. And the times when he's not touring, he's just in Memphis. He's completely isolated. He's up in his bedroom all day. He talks to very few people. And, you know, he's half loopy from drugs. And all he does is ruminate.
Yeah.
He is just in his brain, up there alone, in some darkened fucking bedroom, with tinfoil in the windows.
Yeah.
You know, it's like psychologically the worst thing you can do to yourself.
Yeah. It's essentially like a solitary confinement, like, right?
Yeah. It's terrible. I can definitely say in my own experience, the more I think, the less happy I am, right? Like,
yeah.
No good comes from me thinking about my life.
Right.
And it seems like he just did more and more of that. Mm-hmm. And he's doing it in a psychologically unhealthy state to begin with. So that made me feel bad for him. Is it after he comes back that the colonel like ransacks his house?
No, that is an amazing story.
Yeah. Now, is that early? Is that before
I think
he...
that's
is that in the 60s?
Yeah, I think that is in the 60s. Yeah. Colonel Parker, I think, is always on Larry like, well, we should spend some time together. Like, come out to the house. Yeah. And finally, Larry has to relent. So he's invited out to the colonel's house in Palm Springs. So he brings like his wife and kids with him. And they spend the day with the colonel. And it sounds to me like they just spend the time at his house. They're not really hanging with the colonel. Like, they're swimming in his pool and stuff. And at some point, the colonel beckons him into his office where he's on the phone talking to someone about what, who knows, but it's clearly involves Larry somehow.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
He's saying here. Things like, yeah, he's here. Yeah. Is it done?
And after that phone call, the colonel is like, let's go get some ice cream. So they go get some ice cream. And after that, they go home to find that it's been broken into and ransacked. And they've taken all of his clothes and his wife's clothes. But other than that, two large cans of garbage have been strewn everywhere, along with human urine and feces.
Yeah.
Dude.
Human. Yeah. And they take all his charts on Elvis, all his numerological and astrological charts. Which Larry takes as the colonel obviously setting him up and like an intimidation, like, yeah. You know, he's scared of Larry's powers.
And then later on, it's sort of implied that Elvis knew about it.
Yeah. Like Elvis caught wind of it.
Yeah.
But didn't do anything.
I know what happened. Very sorry about that. That's pretty messed up. But then like the having poo-poo and pee-pee like in the house too, like that's just the icing on the cake.
That's extra nasty.
Yeah. Whose waste is that? Do you think Colonel, like, made a special package? Like,
ugh. Who knows?
It's so weird. And I don't really understand, like, it's just an intimidation job, I guess. A professional intimidation job is how Larry describes it. But why? Just because he's filling Elvis's head full of spiritual gobbledygook? It's never clear to me how that's a huge threat to Elvis. And maybe it's not clear to Larry. So maybe that's why it's not here.
It seems weirdly off-center for Colonel. Like, if Colonel wants to get rid of Larry, there's much more direct ways to do it. And he doesn't seem like a guy who would beat around the bush. Like, he seems like a guy who would call you into his office and be like, I want you out of here.
Yeah.
What do I do to make that happen?
Mm-hmm.
You know, or like, here's my threat. Doing this sort of weird mafia, cut-rate mafia thing seems strange.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't know. Do you believe it? Or do you believe the colonel had anything to do with it?
I mean, from the telling, it sure sounds like it, but I don't know. Like,
yeah.
It seems completely ridiculous, but it's so ridiculous. Why would you make that up? I don't know. I guess it's the urine and the feces that really like...
You're really hung up on that.
Yeah.
You're not happy
like,
about
that's
that.
That's such a specific detail. I don't know.
Well, now I know. I never need to scare you off. Like, where'd
that'd
go?
Do it, man.
Yeah. I mean, my feeling is that it's a situation where that did happen. The colonel probably had nothing to do with it. And it's like, Larry's so convinced he did that he takes these sort of like, you know, he said like, oh yeah, he's here on the phone, meaning mm-hmm. like, oh, he's talking to the pooper. The guy's probably squeezing one out right when he's talking. Yeah. You know, you like go back and you just kind of fill in things.
Yeah. You're
like, oh yeah, but that's what happened. That's my guess. I just don't think the colonel would. But who? I mean, the colonel's definitely an asshole and a thug.
Yeah.
So I'm not saying it's beyond him. It seems to me he would take a different tact. But who's to say? Who knows?
It's a great story.
Yeah, it's a good story. Man, this book is jam-packed, dude.
Yeah.
So a problem with these books and our, much like Elvis, highly studious academic natures... is that we take a lot of notes. I'm looking at Pat's got single-spaced. How many pages of notes?
I've got 7 pages of notes.
And so we talk and we try to get all the interesting stuff out. But there are inevitably...
plenty of these really juicy little nuggets that will really pique the interest of Elvis fans the world over.
Yeah.
But there's not much to them other than they're just juicy little nuggets.
Yeah, there's not much to talk about with them. But they're worth sharing. So we're going to try just a lightning round where we are going to bounce back and forth as quick as we can, hot topics. And if there's anything to talk about, we'll talk. If not, we'll just move on.
Okay.
Fact. There's a lot of good confirmation in here from earlier stuff.
Mm-hmm.
And one thing I thought was interesting was that at one point Elvis is like rifling through a jewelry box and he pulls out a watch. He's like, here, Larry, you have this.
Yeah.
He gives it to him. And Larry flips it over in the back. It says, to Elvis from Nick.
Oh, yeah.
It's from Nick Adams.
Right.
So giving a watch to a guy in the 50s, I mean, I don't know. It seems like a very, like a close gift for two men to give one another.
It also feels like something that was done much more commonly. I don't know.
Maybe.
Especially if you've got the money to do it, I suppose.
That would line up with the fact that Elvis is just like, here, you want this thing?
Well, and what's also striking to me about that story is like later on, it's like Larry's like, oh, I don't know, I gave that to it. Like Elvis gave that to me very nonchalantly. And then I just as nonchalantly, I don't know, I gave it to a fan or something.
Yeah, some lady.
Yeah.
Just gave it to her. Yeah, it's very strange.
I'd want to hang on to that. But I guess, man, Larry's not hung up with the, you know, material things.
The material world. You're right. But it made me kind of feel sad about Nick Adams.
Yeah.
You know?
That's pretty sad.
But it also made me think another project for us is our one act play, To Elvis from Nick.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. It's just you and I.
Oh, man.
To Elvis from Nick.
Oh, man.
But we'll have to do a lot of kissing. So be ready.
All right.
Maybe not a lot, but it definitely, there was definitely just kissing.
And they're definitely nuts to butts.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Half of it's just us on a moped.
Yeah.
Gonna doing a slow circle on the stage. I just keep giving you things. You just keep throwing them over your shoulder. Fact. You know, Gail makes a big point about in the last tour, Elvis making all these cryptic statements from the stage.
Yeah.
And the one was where he said to an audience, by Gail's telling, apropos of nothing, I am and I was. Yeah. One, two, three. And of course, it just seems like, and she takes that as meaning like, you know, somehow that's, I'm going to fake my death. But Larry tells that story here, but it's after he introduces, Are You Lonesome Tonight?
Mm-hmm.
So he goes, the next song, ladies and gentlemen, is Are You Lonesome Tonight? I am and I was. Are you lonesome tonight? I am lonesome. I was lonesome. Completely unremarkable.
Yeah.
Nothing cryptic. I thought that was interesting. Fact. One interesting little bit was that Elvis at one point, he has him going to Carter and trying to become like ambassador to the music scene.
See, I thought it was Jimmy Carter approached him.
Well, I looked it up.
Oh, okay.
In Elvis's telling, Jimmy Carter approached him and was like, I want you to be the youth ambassador or something.
Uh-huh. Youth of America. Or
youth
something.
Of America and the music scene. Special like advisor on the youth of America and the music scene. Which if I looked it up and, you know, Carter says like, yeah, Elvis called me once and I talked to him and he was very incoherent.
Yeah.
And paranoid and was trying to get a presidential pardon for a sheriff friend of his who hadn't even gone on trial yet. And then he says Elvis continued to call him, but he just never picked up the phone again. Yeah. He just let other people take it, which is kind of sad. But that put me into the mind of, you know, the federal agency stuff and him becoming like a secret agent. At one point, he's laying in bed and he's reading this little black book.
Yeah, it's a book that lists all the federal agents in the system or something like that.
Every narcotics agent by city, right? And Elvis is like, man, we got a guy in the Vatican.
Yeah.
Like that's a hotbed of crime and you know, drug smuggling. And it's like, there's no way. Because if the guy's in the Vatican, it means these are secret agents.
Right.
Vatican's not allowing just a U.S. federal agent to be like hanging out in the Vatican.
Well, the fact that somehow it's believable that there's like a list of these people, like, oh, let's compile this list and then give them to all of them. Like, because surely like there's no way these could fall into the wrong hands by mistake.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. And we'll make it really small.
Yeah.
So he just comes in or out of your pocket really easily.
Yeah.
And not only are we going to give it to all our trusted agents, but like, you know, if there's a guy like, oh, I don't know, say Elvis who comes along and wants to get an honorary thing, throw him one too.
Yeah.
So it has to be like they just made it for Elvis. Like Elvis kept calling them.
Oh yeah,
like,
yeah,
hey,
yeah.
Man, yeah, I need to get in touch with some other agents. I got some plans. And eventually they just had to print one up and they put his name in there. And like that'll
you be careful with that, sir.
Yeah, like this is highly important. And just like that'll cool him off for a couple months, right?
Yeah. No, that makes absolute sense to me.
it seems the only way.
Yeah.
Fact.
There's one story where Elvis eats 5 banana splits at one sitting, which I think is really great.
Yeah, for breakfast. Fact.
Elvis gifts a bunch of his guys brand new Lincoln Continental Mark V's. And of course, Larry is very thankful. But then one of Elvis's lackeys, who's unnamed, makes an offhand comment about Larry getting something that really he was entitled to. Elvis hears this, backhands this dude.
Yeah.
and then immediately runs away because he's so shocked at his anger, but hits this guy so bad that he has to be taken to the emergency room. And later on, it's so funny, Elvis breaks this guy's nose or whatever, and then later on he feels terrible about it and he talks to Larry about it, and he asks Larry then to like spend the night with this guy in case he's, you know, really shaken up. But I just love the idea of Elvis like getting so mad he socks a dude, and then he runs upstairs crying. He'd been crying, I think, when Larry sees him again.
And he never apologizes to the guy. He's just it's another thing where it's like, everything's apologizes. Cool now.
Yeah, tell him I'm sorry.
He didn't even say that. He's just like, make sure he's okay. I don't think he says, like, tell him I'm sorry, but just like, tell him I'm up here crying. Or something like that, you know. Fact.
I just want to mention, too, Red seems to have it in for Larry. So early on, they rent out an amusement park in Memphis or around Memphis, and they get on the bumper cars. And I guess here it is. Red West to Larry. I'm going to kill you, you motherfucker, he screamed. I'm going to get you. And I think at the end of that night, Larry talks about being bruised and whiplashed.
Yeah.
And then there's another Red West story much later on where Larry says hello to some people. I think one of them is somebody's girlfriend or Red's girlfriend. And Red takes it the wrong way. He thinks that Larry's been making passes at this woman, and he punches Larry out.
And actually, like, knocks a piece of a chin off his chin bone.
Oh, yeah, he's got floating. Bone floating in,
Larry literally gets whiplash from the bumper car.
Yeah.
He goes to the hospital and is diagnosed with a whiplash, which is like, I don't know. I get a feeling Larry's not that, probably has a weak neck. And yeah, it's actually at a movie set. Red and some of the guys are just like hanging around talking to one of the starlets from the movie.
Mm-hmm.
And Larry comes up and just starts chatting with him. And then he goes in the back and Red punches him out.
I bet Larry was a little insufferable, especially like in Hollywood on movie sets, because he had prior, you know, experience in Hollywood.
You're absolutely right. I didn't really think about that, but yeah, that was more his element. He knew a lot of those people, and those guys were already kind of like rubes, and I'm sure he must have treated them a little bit.
Yeah.
I could see that. Well, that feeds into, you know, they do go into Elvis getting rid of those guys before the book. Elvis, what happened?
Mm-hmm.
And very credible. I've heard that elsewhere, that it was just, he just kept getting sued because they were
hurting so many people. They mentioned that, which like, that makes a lot of sense if they were roughing people up and Elvis was constantly having to pay people off.
Constantly going to court for these guys. So he's like, these guys just got to go. And then it also makes sense that from what we've learned about Elvis, like, he didn't do the firing.
No.
He never said anything. So you're Red West and like, you've been working with this guy for 20 years.
Yeah.
Close.
Yeah.
Friends your whole life. And he just fires you and doesn't even say anything.
Mm-hmm.
And it's because Elvis is weak in that way.
Yeah.
You know, he can't do the confrontation. He can't have that chat with those guys. And so he's just kind of like avoiding it. But that makes it like a million times more hurtful. You know, you just got Vernon being like, all right, you guys are out. Red's an interesting character because everyone kind of loves Red West.
Mm-hmm.
Certainly our group.
Yeah.
But he did write this book that's a really harsh betrayal.
Yeah.
He has his reasons for it that he claims. But he's a
harsh betrayal or just a pointed wake-up call?
A wake-up call to America. I mean, that's his justification for it. It's like anything. There's never one reason you do anything. Mm-hmm. There's always a bunch of reasons. And I can see where all the anger seems very justified.
Sure.
But then, in terms of the guys, there is much talk. At one point where Elvis is like, I'm rewriting my will, and you guys are all, this group of people is taken care of, including you, Larry.
Yeah.
Of course you, Larry. Like always you. And so he writes out this whole will, and all the guys are getting stuff. They have Charlie and I think Ginger both sign it. They're the witnesses. And they just hide it in Graceland. They don't like take it to their lawyer, which is what you would have to do.
Yeah.
You know? And it's, I think it's like 17 pages long. And then Elvis passes and Vernon pulls Charlie in to verify the will for a lawyer. And it's 13 pages long.
Mm-hmm.
And Charlie testifies that it's the real one, is then promptly fired. But the new will is 4 pages shorter. And apparently those 4 pages were all bits about giving it to anyone but Lisa Marie.
Yeah, because in the end, it all is like goes to Lisa Marie in trust, which that makes perfect sense to me.
Really?
As a father? Yeah. And then Larry also paints the picture that like, well, it was just too much for Vernon to deal with. Vernon was in charge of the will. And so if there were changes made sort of after the fact, it was just like, he's so upset and this was the easiest thing to do.
The easiest thing to do was to forge a new will, you know, and then like convince Charlie to go along with it and then like
fire Charlie.
Yeah, I don't know, man.
I guess my point is, like, it's not suspicious to me at all that Elvis would include all these hangers-on in his will. So, I don't know, funny business about forging stuff or wills being changed, like, that seems completely plausible to me that Elvis decided to change the will at some point without the knowledge of Billy Smith and Charlie Hodge and Larry Geller. Like, why would those guys be involved with that at all in the first place? I don't know.
Well, the rewritten will that had them all in it was already pretty late in the game. Mm-hmm. I mean, Ginger was there to witness So it was already late. So him all of a sudden doing another one seems kind of weird.
Uh-huh.
What you're theorizing is that Elvis made the change, not what's presented in the book, which is that Vernon made the change afterward,
mm-hmm.
which in the book, Vernon all but admits to. He comes up, he's of course crying because he's a Presley, up to Larry and is like, I just couldn't do it. It was too much. I just couldn't, you know, mm-hmm. you know what I'm talking about. I'm so sorry.
Yeah.
But, you know, I just couldn't. And it's like, I can kind of see that happen.
Yeah.
Like Vernon doing that. But on the other hand, he was going to give $50,000 to Billy Smith and he's doing that to like eight guys.
Yeah.
It's 400 grand.
Right.
And you know, Elvis had, he must have had a shitload of money. And if Vernon had any sense, he knew there was a shitload of money still going to come in.
But Vernon was also like notoriously like penny dumb. Pinching, right? So like maybe there's not as much money in the bank as we think there was, or that amount, the plenty that was, is just like Vernon still thinks it's like, oh, it's drying up.
That very well could be. But to that, I would say, you know, if he did change the will, your theory that Elvis changed the will,
mm-hmm.
Elvis was nothing but generous to those guys.
Yeah.
And the guys who were still with him at the end were kind of proven.
Mm-hmm.
They weren't guys he was getting rid of, guys he thought were, you know, shitty.
The core guys for the most part. Yeah.
Yeah. And he spent his whole life giving those guys gifts. Mm-hmm. It makes sense that he would want to leave them something in his will.
Yeah.
And 50 grand is not that much for him.
I don't know. Like, I can't listen to these guys like Larry or any of these guys complain about how they're not in the will and like how they feel betrayed. It's just like, you had a years long ride. That should be enough. And so the fact that all goes to Lisa Marie, that's what should have happened. And so I can't listen to your argument, Larry Geller or Billy Smith or whoever, or Charlie Hodge. Oh, you had to go like earn your keep some other way?
Yeah, I can see them, especially if you're told you're going to be in the will. Mm-hmm. I can see you being upset by that.
Yeah.
And thinking it's weird. I can see your stance. Those guys don't have much to complain about, but there's a difference between complaining and going like, what the fuck? This is weird, you know?
Mm-hmm.
So, fact. This great moment where it's very near the end and Larry, for some reason, he's of course massaging Elvis's scalp and shampooing him. And he's like, you know, Elvis, have you ever considered stopping to dye your hair? You have a beautiful white head of hair. Wouldn't you look very dynamic on stage in one of your jumpsuits with long flowing white hair? And Elvis literally says like, well, I'll think about that. Clearly, like, what are you talking about?
He also talks about Elvis, like, losing eyebrow hair, which I think is kind of funny.
Funny or super depressing. Yeah. I think I took that as depressing. But the white hair thing, it's like Jackie Rogers Jr. is exactly, that's Jackie Rogers Jr.
Oh, man.
Fact. This confirms that Elvis is embarrassed to even see dungarees or even brown clothes.
Right.
Because they reminded him of being a poverty-stricken
working class
youth,
jerk off, yeah.
Which is a theory you had had.
Yeah.
Early on we had talked, I think, you know.
Came to me in a dream.
Yeah, I think in an off-mic conversation discussing Elvis, you would opine that Elvis probably would never wear denim because he associated it with poverty. And I think you were right. This was great. Fact.
Just a quote from the book. To one female interviewer who asked what he did with all the girls who threw themselves at him, he replied, I usually take them. Which is kind of like antithetical to what Larry talks about a lot. He's like, Elvis would go overboard with everything, except when it came to sex.
Yeah.
Which is, so Elvis went overboard with everything. I'm supposed to believe like he drew the line at sex. And like, especially after reading the Greenwood book, it's like, not sure I buy that. Like, good on you, Larry, for like trying to defend Elvis, but I'm not buying it.
Larry does take that line, and he describes some of these parties in Hollywood and in Memphis where, you know, in fact, he would send Red or whoever down to the fence, gather up some gals, bring them up to the house, and they'd have a party. And in Greenwood's book, those parties take on a sinister hue, right? As they all start banging each other.
Hey, there's nothing wrong with a little banging.
a little four-way among a family. But in this, like, Larry really makes the point of saying these parties are extremely chaste.
Yeah.
It's like singing.
And soda pop.
And potato chips. Mm-hmm. And there's really no sex going on. There's just some chatting. And at one point, Elvis is telling him, like, you know, right when I got drafted, the week before I went in, I went crazy and I slept with everything that moved. I realized I really need some, like, love involved. I'm not interested in just the physical.
Yeah.
But, you know, none of that equates with those couple shots in Elvis on Tour where he's talking about getting blowjobs.
Yeah.
Very, like, crudely.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, backstage and one's in a limo. Mm-hmm. It's like, man, that girl last night could really suck a dick or something like that,
yeah, yeah.
Right? Or, and all the guys are like, Elvis. So I take that as saying, like, well, we've got video or we've got filmic proof of Elvis being kind of a dog.
Mm-hmm.
So I would say without thinking that, oh, Larry is mistaken or Larry's kind of trying to cover him up, which is great. Honestly, if that was the case, I'd say bravo, Larry. But then I did some further thinking.
Uh-huh.
And I do believe Elvis was impotent.
Oh.
And Elvis on Tour was pretty late in the game.
Yeah.
So there is a very strong possibility that his bragging, especially to the guys, like, oh, that chick last night.
He doth protest too much.
Right?
Yeah.
He's making a big show about, oh, man, she really sucked a good hard dick.
I blew so many loads last night.
Yeah. You know how your dick gets so hard? So I 100% believe that Elvis, you know, once he went limp dick, would still find it very important, even if he had never done that before, to be very vocal to the guys about, like, oh, man.
Yeah, I can see that.
So maybe Elvis was a sweetheart with the gals.
But not by choice is kind of what you're saying, like.
Well, no. Briefly, I mean, my point is just that I think there's a possibility he was always pretty chaste with the ladies.
Mm-hmm.
And that his acting otherwise on Elvis on Tour doesn't necessarily negate that idea.
Okay.
That's all I'm saying. And I think this is also a situation where, much like the relationship between Elvis and his parents, like, for whatever reason, I really want them to have had a nice relationship. I want him and Vernon to be loving. I don't want, you know, like, their Greenwood paints like a real hateful, gross relationship.
Yeah, and I'm going to be swayed by, like, whatever book that I'm, like, currently reading. But that rang true to me while I was reading the Greenwood book. But it sounds from Larry's telling that they were close and they did have a good relationship.
And it's like...
The more I read that, the more I would like to believe that as well. Because if Elvis doesn't even have that, like, his life is even sadder. And then it just becomes more depressing to think about Elvis. Like, he just, I don't know. I want to like Elvis and I want to be rooting for Elvis. I don't want him to just be like a totally tragic figure.
Yeah, you want him having fun. And it, you know, in listening to the music, I can listen to music of people who are miserable and who are shitty people. But, you know, when I listen to Elvis, as I do often, as you can imagine, I'm clearly looking for something above and beyond just music.
Yes.
And the Elvis music gives me something, some weird comfort.
Yeah, there's definitely something more about Elvis and his music than just the music.
But I think there's something in that feeling is they're under threat when I start thinking about this being so dark.
Yeah.
And Elvis being a dark character. Like, it really affects me in a way that, like, Michael Jackson music, I'm not affected by at all. I still like Michael Jackson music. I don't care how terrible I find out he is. It doesn't make a difference, you know. And that's the same with, like, the promiscuity. Not that there's anything wrong with banging. Like, I'm all for banging, but...
You want a high five on that one?
Yeah, dog. I mean, I say that hypothetically. But I don't know. I guess just the level of banging he was engaged in the Greenwood made me kind of uncomfortable.
Yeah, it was very aggressive.
Yeah.
Almost hateful.
Fact. We do learn that Elvis was, according to Larry, obsessed with women's feet. The minute I see a woman's foot, I know if I like her or not.
Well, and then the actual sentence, he was obsessed with women's feet.
Yeah.
And then it goes nowhere. That's all we get.
It's the only mention. And my feeling is that sentiment, the minute I see a woman's foot, I know if I like her or not, really does not necessarily mean he was a foot fetishist.
Right.
It could very likely mean, I mean, I could say the same thing, because, like, if I see a woman's foot, I get to get a good idea of what's going on with the rest of her.
Right.
If she has some nasty, beat up, dirty foot, right?
Well, and it's like they say, you know, the feet are the window into a person's soul.
So, yeah, I don't buy that. I think Larry's making a leap there, taking that to mean there's some obsession there. But who knows? Maybe in further books, I'll be very interested to see if feet come up more.
Yeah.
Fact.
I thought it was interesting to note that Larry singles out Jerry Schilling and Charlie Hodge as bright and sensitive at some point. I think I take that to mean like they like didn't dismiss his spiritual bullshit right away.
I could see that.
Yeah.
I could see Charlie.
And I don't know, like having read Charlie Hodge's book, Me and Elvis, not a big fan of that guy. But man, everybody loves Charlie, it sounds like. So I might need to rethink.
Well, I'm so curious because I've read that book too, and I remember nothing from it, but I did not have any kind of negative feelings towards Charlie after.
Oh.
But you...
Yeah, I couldn't stand it. I think it's just that like he positions himself as sort of like a wise advisor to Elvis. And man, that's rich for a guy who's like...
A glorified mobile closet.
Exactly. A human microphone stand. Like, he's not any advisor to Elvis in any capacity as far as I can tell. But what do I know?
Yeah.
But he likes the guy.
Fact. Elvis thinks there are descriptions of UFOs in the book of Ezekiel, which is like the most 70s belief.
Oh, I know, man. Chariots of the God shit, right?
He is a compendium of 70s nonsense beliefs.
Like, yeah.
If Elvis didn't have that element to him, he would be so much less compelling, right? If he just found like Elvis, he would occasionally read like airport books.
Oh, yeah.
And then just went to like a Protestant church every Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It'd be so boring. Fact.
I've got a quote here sort of illustrating what an emotional guy Elvis was. Watching a news report about abused children or seeing a film on the Holocaust, Elvis would clench his fist and curse, "God damn them," with tears rolling down his cheeks.
Questions. What was Elvis wearing when he was first introduced to Larry's wife?
Oh, I don't remember. I want to say it was like a black jumpsuit and he had a flashlight in hand. No,
a black bolero shirt.
Oh,
black pants and a loaded shoulder holster.
Nice.
Questions. What's the sign outside of the colonel's office read?
I should know, but I don't remember.
Elvis exploitations.
Oh, yeah.
Is that insane?
Yeah.
Like, I guess exploitation at that point didn't mean the same thing, but it's very...
It's a little on the nose, huh?
Yeah, I'd say so, right? Fact. They do confirm there was a nurse and a doctor. It was a home birth for Elvis and Jesse. They confirm that the story Vernon would tell of going into the backyard and it's infused with a mystical blue light. And so that answers my question. I guess both of our questions, but I'll take most of the heat for it, of what happened to Jesse. Whereas I thought it was a home birth and so no doctors around. Vernon was probably tasked with writing himself for the baby and being lazy. He probably just kind of hucked it in some woods.
God.
out of a moving truck. But I guess if there was a doctor there, I assume the doctor would have taken it.
Yeah.
And so Jesse was buried. It's called Priceville Cemetery. It is an unmarked grave near some family plots. So rest easy with all that. Questions. What's interesting about the custom watch Elvis has made?
Oh, it like every so often it flashes a cross and a Star of David, I think.
Every 30 seconds, it showed the cross and the Star of David together for 20 seconds.
Wow.
So you'd have 10 seconds of clock time. So 20 seconds per minute, you'd have clock. Right. And then 40 seconds of... That's a good fucking watch. Fact.
Colonel maybe has a cohort proposition Larry. Like one of the Colonel's buddies invites Larry out to dinner and then starts kind of like touching him under the table. And Larry thinks that maybe it's the Colonel trying to feel him out.
Yeah, literally. The idea being that the Colonel's suspicious about his sexual orientation.
Yeah.
I'm sure all those guys were. I did think it was interesting that Larry at one point cites Priscilla's book as a source for him getting some background information on his firing, some of the discussions that went on.
Oh.
And I just thought, like, how weird would that be? Like, you can buy these mass market paperbacks and learn about your own life.
That is crazy.
You know? And then I immediately thought, like, we all need to start writing books. Me, you, Burl, and Wade.
How about an oral history of Hennessy?
That's a great idea. Fact.
Larry's kids are named Jova and Cabrel.
Questions. What percent of Japanese homes watched Aloha?
90.
Very good, Pat. Fact. This was interesting. Larry does state that in the 60s, Elvis did have an early video camera.
Mm-hmm.
And he did indeed tape girls taking off their clothes a couple times, but that was the extent of it.
Yep.
I find that hard to believe. I think.
What about that do you find hard to believe?
I think if you have your video camera out and you've already like looked at a girl in your bedroom and looked at the camera and looked at the girl and said, you know what, hun? Watch. And then start filming her as she takes off her top and you start zooming in on the boobs and stuff like that. It's such a small step to then go into like, well, why don't you, you know, kiss my nipples and then I'll see what that looks like. Oh, that feels good. You know?
Yeah.
I don't see that being the line. I can see the line being I don't want to record any sexual shenanigans on a video camera because it's gross. Mm-hmm. But I don't see the line being like, oh, with your taking your clothes off, I'll videotape it. But no, like actual.
Yeah. I feel like if you have that, like a few times might be the key thing for me. So maybe Elvis doesn't want to have sex on camera. I get that. Or maybe there's just like not a tripod around. But like, I don't know. I feel like if you're going to do that, you're going to just like. He's got like a library of tapes.
He is a whole hog kind of guy.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. But this is a sexual matter. Is this where he draws the line?
The idea of him not wanting to see himself have sex, or maybe he recorded it once and didn't like it and just stopped. That would make sense. I was definitely just picturing him videotaping himself getting like blowjobs and stuff. Mm. Like that being more his speed. Fact. I've, in the past, I think by default, because I'm maybe a contrarian at heart, I've always kind of been something of a kernel apologist in that people like to kind of drag him through the mud and, oh, he worked him to death and he was a kind of a shitty guy. And
yeah.
Unfair to Elvis financially and all this. And my stance is always like, yeah, I think that's kind of true, but also look at what he did.
Yeah.
You know, he did some amazing things. He invented superstardom in a sense. So you got to cut him some slack. But this book, they go into some of the deals he was cutting, and I cannot get past this and still have anything even remotely warm in terms of feelings towards the Colonel.
Yeah, yeah.
I mean, he talks about selling all the masters pre, like, I think, 73 to RCA. And they throw in some other stuff in the deal. And the what it totals to is Elvis gets $4.65 million, which is a tidy sum. But the Colonel gets 6.2, which is like, what? How much of a dirtbag do you have to be?
Yeah.
It's unbelievably greedy and shitty.
Yeah.
You know? And then that's around the same time he sets up Boxcar International, which is to handle all of Elvis's merch. And that's a company the Colonel sets up. He gets 40% of it. Elvis gets 15% of it. Ugh. The fact that he could be fair to Elvis and make still so much goddamn money.
Yeah.
I mean, who's earning more than Elvis? Elvis was the highest paid actor in Hollywood.
Yeah, yeah.
He was getting $1 million fee plus 50% of the profits, I'm sure net.
Yeah.
But, I mean, that's an insane amount of money. So his greed is really grotesque to me. And his disdain towards Elvis that suggests
really
shines through.
Oh,
right?
For sure. Yeah. And, like, I'm no fan of the Colonel, but it's also, like, if you can get over on somebody like that, like, good on you. Elvis has got to take some accountability for being such a sap, right? Like,
yeah, for sure.
I don't know.
100%. I don't think those are mutually exclusive sentiments, like thinking the Colonel's a shit and that Elvis was a fucking idiot and blew it.
Yeah.
And had a direct hand in his own downfall.
Yeah, yeah.
I think both of those are true. But yeah, and it does make me wonder how much the guys, the Memphis Mafia, would have been looking out for Elvis versus how much of their time is spent looking out for the Colonel's interests.
Yeah.
And reading those stats, I couldn't help but think some whiff of the terms of those deals has to be out there.
Yeah.
People in the industry must know this.
Right.
Which suggests to me that Elvis would be getting approached almost constantly by other managers who could say, dude, overnight, you'll be making three times the money, four times the money.
Yeah.
And the fact that, you know, Elvis seems to have never felt he could never step away from the Colonel because it was always stepping into darkness.
Right.
It was never like, oh, I got this lined up. Mm-hmm. I just say, adios, Colonel, and I've got this guy ready to roll.
Yeah.
Suggests those people never got to Elvis.
Yeah,
or
yeah.
He had been trained not to listen to that somehow.
Uh-huh. Or he has this just weird sense of loyalty that he just can't shake.
Could be any of those things. But it does make me wonder, like, how much of the Memphis Mafia's time, like, how many of them were complicit in barring other agents and managers and financial, like, money managers from getting to Elvis, you know? Because there had to be a steady stream of people trying to get to him because it's such a slam dunk.
Yeah, well, and I think Larry doesn't name names, but like clearly there were guys like on the inside serving as an ear for the Colonel. like, yeah, who are reporting back to the colonel with what's going on. So, I mean, Elvis was so deep in his bubble that I think it would be hard to get in anyway. But then if you've got guys like working to keep people out, it becomes even more difficult. You know, Elvis also like talks about like, you know, business isn't really my thing and just didn't want to even think about that stuff. So he's got all that stuff working against him and that works in the colonel's favor.
There is a funny thing talking about finances. Do you remember the story where Larry is suggesting to Vernon that he start investing money?
Oh, yeah.
And he tells him that what,
like
gold
is... like you should invest in gold, Vernon.
Yeah. This is so sad and like so in keeping with the portrait of Vernon you get.
Yeah.
So what's Vernon do with that hot information, that insider?
He buys like a gold coin or something.
Yeah. And that's it.
That's it.
He shows it to Larry. He's like carrying it around.
Yeah.
So Larry says, gold's going up, invest in gold. Yeah. The market is changing. So he buys a gold piece and just like carries it around. But those guys needed a money manager who wasn't in the colonel's pocket. In terms of the colonel, there's a big stink that I find very telling about the colonel being a really shitty, degenerate gambler.
Mm-hmm.
At one point, losing like over $1 million in Vegas in one night,
yeah,
which is a pretty bad loss. That's a streak. But then later on, the colonel sets up the deal for Elvis's, what turns out to be his final tour. Obviously, they didn't know it was his final tour at the time. To have a couple of the shows filmed to be broadcast, I think, at CBS.
Mm-hmm.
And Elvis is not happy because Elvis is in bad shape. He's not in great voice. He knows he looks bad.
He really is stressed about those shows being filmed, yeah.
And it's coming on top of the book coming out, Elvis What Happened coming out. Elvis is very stressed. But he's complaining at one point about, oh, that dang colonel selling these rights, filming these concerts. He must have lost more money gambling or something, mm-hmm. You know, that bastard. And that is so telling in that only a guy who feels he can't say no to something would complain like that.
Yeah, the colonel's positioned it so that Elvis works for him. And that's got to be how Elvis sees it.
That's a really interesting way to put it. And I think you're totally right. I don't think Elvis consciously ever thought, oh, I'm working for the colonel. But mm-hmm. That's definitely how he's approaching it.
Yeah.
That's definitely the world he's living in.
Yeah.
Only in that mindset would he be upset about the colonel's gambling. Because
mm-hmm.
Otherwise, it's the colonel's money. Who gives a shit?
Right.
But it's because he feels there's a direct connection between the colonel needing money and Elvis having to work.
Yeah.
That he gets upset.
Yep.
Because he doesn't feel he can say no. And that says a lot. And it actually probably answers a lot of stuff we talked about earlier. Like, why couldn't Elvis get away from him? That level of being ineffectual, it's like pretty staggering. It's pretty sad. Fact.
There is a detail in one story where the boys are in the back room watching Deep Throat on Betamax.
Fact.
Whenever they talk about Vernon having a heart attack, I think of Sanford and Son. I know it was way more serious than that. I think Vernon probably didn't take great care of himself either, but I put that together with his like outburst at the funeral. It's like, oh, Elvis, I'll be seeing you soon.
That definitely, we find out where Elvis gets a lot of his emo behavior.
Yeah.
Because Vernon, has exactly that. I'll be with you soon, son. Crying freak out at the internment. And earlier at the viewing at Graceland, Minnie May had like completely collapsed.
Yeah.
And was like, he was the prettiest thing I'd ever seen. And she had made such a scene, she'd be escorted and put into her room.
Right.
So there's like 8,000 people or whatever going through looking at the coffin. And she's 20 paces off under the stairs in her room and having to be kept away from people because she'll freak them out. Fact.
So speaking of psychology, things going over like guys' heads, I love this passage here. On the way to the hotel, I sat next to Dean Nicopolis. He said to me naively, hey, great show tonight, huh? I looked at him in astonishment. Maybe he's blinded because his father is Dr. Nick. I don't know. I said, you're only 21 years old, Dean, and you're so lucky to be here. We all are. Let me give you a word of advice. Take in every moment to its fullest. Try to absorb everything that's going on because nothing lasts forever. You're young. Someday you'll be grown up and you'll look back on this and it will all seem like a dream. Look around you. See what's happening. This won't last forever. Dean stared at me for a moment with a concerned look in his eyes. I thought that perhaps I had struck a chord in him. Then he said, what the hell are you talking about? Are you using that psychological stuff on me?
I definitely picture that taking place with Larry's hand on Dean's knee. Right, like take every advantage of every moment. Live
or actually, he's got his hand, like his face in his hands. Like,
what are you talking about, Mr. Geller?
What the hell are you talking about?
Questions. What technique did Elvis have to resort to as a child to deal with his asthma?
I don't remember.
He would take off his shirt and rub his back against a tree like a bear. Fact.
There's a story where Elvis almost chokes on a cheeseburger while nodding off.
Fact.
Sex energy is the strongest energy in the body, according to Elvis.
Fact.
The opening to this book is really awesome. It's details Larry and Charlie Hodge being like taken into the coroner's office, like post autopsy. They got to get it ready for the funeral. He's going to do his hair. The coroner comes in and like takes the sheet off Elvis and they get to see Elvis's stitched torso. And Charlie remarks like, why'd you have to do that? Like, they didn't have to see Elvis like that.
Well, remember they took out his guts and kept him. They never put him back in. And in this book, when Larry cuts his hair that last time, he keeps the hair.
Yeah. Don't hear any more about that though.
No. Oh, where'd that go?
Yeah.
Pretty creepy. Probably stuffed a pillow. Fact.
Elvis hung out with James Brown a little bit.
Yeah.
James Brown was a big Elvis fan, it sounds like.
Yeah, James made a point to come to the visitation at Graceland and like was left alone with the body for what seemed like hours.
Yeah.
And just sat silently with him. So I guess according to this telling, it had a deep mutual respect. So this book, what do you think, man?
I really enjoyed reading it. Like, I think there are a lot of great stories in here. I do like Larry. He seems like a good guy. I don't know that I completely buy his spiritual influence over Elvis. I just don't feel Elvis was as committed to his studies as maybe Larry wants him to be.
Yeah.
But Larry seems pretty credible. He's got some other stuff going on besides Elvis, which I think always helps. And I don't know, maybe it's him working his psychology on me. But he does seem to take the high road with a lot of stuff in telling these stories.
Yeah, I mean, Larry's clearly no dope. I mean, he's like a cultured dude.
Mm-hmm.
He's intelligent and he's educated and he grew up, you know, he lives in the Hollywood world. So it's like, it's a demanding space where you have to be socially aware.
Right.
In a way that I think a lot of authors of these books never had to be, you know? So I think he does come off as very different. Yeah, I'd agree. I really, really enjoyed this book. I had read it before, but this time through, it was really engrossing. Like I said, I agree that the reading of this, you feel it's very credible and he is very likable and he seems trustworthy, though I do question whether he's just using psychology on us. Because in review, there's a lot of questions. And again, we can't get past the fact that it's another book written by someone who, to fully believe a story, you have to believe that he is psychic, that Elvis can heal people with his hands.
Right.
Great shop. Make sure to tune in. Next week, we're reading a book written by a woman named something Bova.
Joyce Bova. The name of the book is Don't Ask Forever, My Love Affair with Elvis. So
yeah, about secret sex with Elvis.
Yeah.
That'll be hot. Before we go, we'd like to make special mention of our cousin podcast, Suspicious Minds, with
Wade and Burl.
Very good. They're good friends of ours. And are, in fact, doing really good work in the name of Elvis. So give them a listen, if you will. If you'd like to get in touch with us, you can email at elvisbookclub@gmail.com or give us a call and leave a message at 312-380-1114. All right, Pat. And so we part, and we do so in the manner of all Elvis fans the world over by saying a few simple words. You know, Pat, there was a guy I said one time, he said, you never stood in that man's shoes.
Or saw things through his eyes.
Or stood and watched with helpless hands.
While the heart inside you dies.
So help your brother along the way, no matter where he starts.
For the same God that made you, made him too.
These men with broken hearts. Good night.
And God bless. Everybody's gone away.